house, and he stands directly behind me, grabs the back of my pants, and whoop!
Having kids at my age is kind of like getting a DUI just as you pull into your driveway.
If you panicked during the pandemic, shake your antidepressants. You guys know what you should.
The opening into the show felt like the end of summer going into school. It was like absolutely chaotic mayhem, and then it was just absolute beautiful silence. Hi everybody, welcome to a very special Parents Lounge this evening. Jamie Kaler joined as always by my co-hosts, Mr. Jason Gowan and Katie.
Hello.
Hey guys. Hello.
Hi JK.
My kids don't start till next week, but apparently Ms. Mulligan's kids went today.
Yesterday.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How did that feel?
Well, okay. There's a couple of things that happened.
Oh, no.
One is that I'm on the PTA executive board this year. Sure. So last week, I was at a five-hour meeting on Wednesday night from 5:30 till 10:30, not a joke. And then we set up for registration, and then I worked all the registrations, which there were three, because they want to be equitable. Like there's parents that can only be there early in the morning. If there's parents that only can come at night, if there's parents that whatever. So I worked at the school all last week. We have a new principal. And then I just felt like I was done. I was like, I cannot do anything else. And then had to actually come and like face the fact that nothing about my life is ready for these kids to go to school. Yeah. Jamie, looks like you have a question. Yes. Jamie,
yeah, I have
hi.
A question.
Hi. Sorry. Could you please state your name and what?
Hi, Jamie Kaler. I have
who are you with?
It's not so much a question as a statement about all of that.
Yeah.
So all I can tell you is about so you just spoke for about 30 seconds about the PTA meeting.
Yeah.
And that was one of the most painful 30 seconds I've ever spent.
Yes, I understand. Thank you for the question, Jamie.
So, I forgot where I was.
It's not a question.
Sir, this is a press conference. We're not. Okay, yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
So if that was that painful, mm-hmm,
yeah.
Then, you how can only, painful you can, was the five-hour meeting?
You can only imagine. Well, I'll tell you this. You're going to love this story. There's a mom that I'd never met there. I come in a little bit late, classic me. And there's a mom that I've never met. And she is really... she's really knows a lot. She's like giving a lot of input. Mm-hmm. And I find out their name's Jen. I look at the list. I see that there's a woman named Jen. And then like, she's really rubbing me.
You checked her credentials, right?
No. I was trying to figure out. I was like, well, who is it? Well, this is going to come in important. I was like, oh, Jen Kapari. Okay. So she's all right. So that must be who that is.
Oh, I've now you've added her.
I mean,
that's not actually the last name.
No, we're using fake names. And honestly, Campari is part of a Negroni. So I think it's it's a great choice.
So anyway, at some point she's like, we're talking about where to put this sponsor. Does everybody have a school that does sponsor banners? It's like Burbank High is proudly sponsored by Pella Windows, like, and you put
it's,
a banner.
It's not even Burbank High at my school. It's like the rear stairwell to the building has been sponsored by Tom and Evelyn. Yeah,
I have never seen that until I came to when we went to your girl's school that day. I had never seen sponsored anything ever.
Actually,
it's not a thing here.
Here we'll talk about this eventually because our special guest today, the wonderful actor and director Christine Lakin,
so excited to have her
was
back.
Sitting in the front row as I hosted the auction for all of those spaces around my school.
Oh,
she
wow.
was sitting there, and I was like, all right, this is a parking spot we're auctioning off, which was actually a real one, but some of them were just your name was on the back of the gym. On
love
the there's one on the alley, the gate to the alley gets sponsored. People like $3,000, you're like, sure, it's yours, you got it.
So we sell banners to businesses. And anyway, so the woman that's proposing we do this said, so we'll put it on the front of the school. And this other woman that I'm not vibing off of, who like seems to be a big know-it-all and has a lot of input on stuff I don't think she should have. She's just a fucking mom like us. is like, oh, I don't. She goes, oh, excuse
hey!
Me. You know what? I'm sorry. I should have said the F word. But also, if in it. My defense, I did mean it.
Well, I didn't honestly, none of us, no one even in the audience thought for a second.
See, there's a payoff. There is a payoff. Okay. There is a payoff to this.
I hope so, because that's editing work for me.
I'm sorry. So anyway, so she's an effing mom like me. And I'm like, why is she talking about this? She's like, I don't want them on the front of the school. And I was like, oh, I disagree. I think it's a great place to show that we're supported when people are dropping their kids off. It's great to see that we're supported by all these businesses. And then when they revisit it, they're like, okay, so we'll do the banners on this other street. I'm like, wait, just because Jen says we have to do them on that side, we do it on that side? And she goes, actually, it's a decision I do get to make. It was the principal, guys. It was the new principal. That's who was in the meeting. It wasn't another effing mom. It was the principal.
So the new principal, her name is Jen Campare.
Jen Campare. Hey. So I shot myself directly in the foot out of the gate.
So on when they have those
that's
books.
That's why she knew so much.
How to make so when they have those books on how to make friends and influence people.
Yeah.
I missed that one.
You missed that book.
I didn't read it, and I certainly didn't write it.
I'm sorry. Who are you again? I'm the principal of the school. Never mind, my mistake. I'm so sorry. Yeah. The gift basket.
Did you put
on its way.
Mulligan? How dare you?
I mean, I was truly. I was like, this lady just keeps running. Okay, she's the principal. Got it. That makes a lot. I got it now. Mm-hmm.
By the way, if that's not a scene in the pilot of your new sitcom, I can't help you. We should have Murphy. We should have Murphy come in for the second half with Adam Harrington.
Murphy. So, Kate, what happened after that? Like, did you interact with her after? Like,
she. I got to tell you, she's going to actually be an incredible principal. She seems to have forgiven me, but I still need to write her an apology note because I'm going to have to be honest with her. Like I just to be perfectly honest, I did not know you were you, and I would have not welcomed you to our school by being like, by contesting your opinions. And I'm sorry about that.
Feels pretty on brand.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't. Honestly, what I will tell you is that today I saw a father yelling at the crossing guard because he didn't want to cross with her. And I lost my goddamn mind on that guy. And I'm sorry I said
Back up. He didn't want to cross.
He was yelling at the crossing guard, Jamie.
Because he didn't want to cross with the crossing guard?
He wanted to just cross his kid by himself. But that, why are you fighting with the, she's there. She makes $3 an hour. She is there to keep our kids safe. Just listen to her and just wait until she crosses you.
He couldn't walk with her?
He did not. He wanted to just do his own thing. He didn't want to wait for her.
Now, listen, here's what I always argue. You never know somebody else's path, right? You've never lived in his footsteps. And to be honest with you, I wouldn't be shocked if when he was a young boy, he had been maybe kidnapped by a crossing guard and molested horribly. And he still has deep scars concerning crossing guards. And maybe it's just an ulterior.
So yeah,
go ahead, Kate.
No, I was going to say, I think the other possibility is that he was an entitled penis.
Listen, it could go one way or the other.
It's hard to know.
But in Los Angeles,
it's hard to know.
By the way, really quick. Do you know where the number one most expensive rentals are in California?
No, where?
Glendale. Glendale, Santa Monica, number two.
Where's Beverly Hills in that?
So maybe that dude, maybe he's part of the Glendale elite and he is just
But this is Burbank.
Maybe he liked your school and he's so rich that
guy's credit, I will tell you that when I was like, don't fight with her. She is here. She is here because the city has her here. We are supposed to cross with her. He's like, well, I didn't know that. I'm like, that's fine. You know now. I also didn't know last year. And she had to tell me. I'm like, but just so you know. He's like, well, somebody almost hit me and they acted like I wasn't supposed to be crossing. I'm like, that's because you were not supposed to be crossing. Because
a rogue walker.
Also, here's the thing. If you don't want to cross with the crossing guard, go down to the other intersection where there is no crossing guard. If you go to the intersection with the crossing guard, you have to follow her instructions. You have to.
This has really affected you.
Yeah.
I
don't like PTA.
You're not having a good week.
No, can I tell you why it bothers me? I cannot stand when people have status over somebody and treat them like garbage the way this guy did. Nothing makes me madder in this world than somebody with any bit of status treating somebody with lower status as if they work for you.
I can't. Honestly, Kate, I'm done with you. You're out.
There's a certain peace now.
It got calm. Did you feel it?
It did, yeah. It was like a...
I wish I was back in the middle.
You like it in the middle.
There you go.
Thank you.
Yeah, there it is.
I'm sorry, princess. I didn't realize that we here. Let me just
to both of you.
Picture we like.
It doesn't come square if I.
Well, I think honestly, I'm in such a good mood tonight for some reason. I feel like this is a great start. We have Angry Kate. By the way, Angry Kate, I find to be the funniest of all the Kates.
Really? No. I said nothing funny. I said nothing that wasn't.
Oh, scary. Are you kidding?
It was entertaining for us.
Oh, it was a character study. It was an SNL monologue. It wasn't joke laden. It was all in the performance. It was like a Groundling sketch, really.
How very.
I mean, if you'd have had a crazy wig and you were at like a bank teller, that's like a 7-minute sketch.
Here we go. Here we go.
That's it right there. Yeah. PTA mom. Honestly, PTA mom, I feel, is like a Mike Myers character.
Yeah. I just, let's be nice to people that we have more status over. That's all. That's all
right.
People.
Well, unfortunately, I'm at the very bottom of everything, so I just look up at everybody.
Jason. Honestly, yeah.
I love having. Honestly, we were always looking for some spark in the beginning, and we found it. It's Mulligan. Mulligan. Mulligan's like the spark plug that lights the fire. All right, listen.
To Patrick Murphy. He said this has already been the most relatable show I've ever listened to.
It honestly is. Honestly, I feel like the less Jason and I talk and the more Kate talks, the more people go, oh, parenting. Yeah, now I get it. It's really painful. I totally.
The more people are like, oh, I do need to
talk about. We have a wonderful couple guests. Christina Lakin's here. We have Adam Harrington's here, and we have a lot to talk about. Adam Harrington's here. Did you know? Oh, you didn't know tonight. Yeah. And Christine's here.
Did you even read the emails, Mulligan?
I know. Our old buddy from back east, an old friend here. Jamie finally got it. More. Yes, Katie. Honestly, Katie, listen, I'm not telling you I'm smart. It took a while, but I finally got it. All right. Hey, listen, we're going to give you guys 90 seconds. Go make yourself a delicious drink. Be sure if you're taking this time, go share the show to your page because there's other parents that need to hear what we're talking about. And we'll be back after these 90 seconds with Christine Lakin.
We could have homes on separate cools, go dive in Greece with squids. Could have been so bleeping rich, but instead we had kids. They won't smile for a photo. They won't eat the food we choose. That's why we're heading to the parents' lounge to drown ourselves in booze. Every day we're more exhausted. We haven't slept in years. They hit me in the nuts so bad my eyes filled up with tears. And yes, we'd like to fake our death. Go off of the grids, but the truth is we are softies and we truly love our kids. So join us every Tuesday night to laugh at all our pain. Evening in the parents' lounge is the cure to staying sane.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, yo,
Christine, how are you?
I'm good. Hold on, I gotta turn my light on.
Kate Mulligan texted me something in the chat that is a personal thing between mutual friends that we have that I did not know that I am blown away by. It's the greatest.
I'm gonna have a hard time keeping my mouth shut.
Actually, Christine can see it.
I'm sorry, I can't share.
Oh no, but Christine can see that. Yeah,
you can see it in the private chat. You can see that.
It's great.
Yes,
great. Who doesn't love that?
You, what kind of angel just floats in here with that skin?
This skin?
That skin. I'll, oh my God. I will
not this hair. Not this hair.
Yeah.
Well, you are part of the family at this point. Not only have you been on the show before, but you performed live with us.
I did.
Murdered live.
Now
you're touring. Was great.
You're touring stadiums, from what I understand.
Yep, stadiums. They're, you know, they're, it's just the, really the steps of my living room. And my kids sit on them, so it feels like a stadium. And I do lots of material for them. They don't.
Now that was your first stand-up set.
Nothing's
that you did.
Ever been more annoying to me. Nothing's ever been more.
That's first honestly, time, it made me angry. It made me angry. You're not supposed
I've done storytelling and stuff before, and I've hosted a lot of comedy shows and things like that. But I've never done.
I thought you were fantastic, and I was very supportive on like those two.
Yeah.
Thank you.
How dare you?
How are the kids? Is everybody back in school? I'm not back yet. We're not back until next week.
Us either.
Oh yes, we went back on Monday. It's glorious. It really is. It's just wow. But here's the rub. Okay. Number one's back in school. Number two is still in preschool. And guess what they do? They stop on Friday until after Labor Day. Just when you get one in, they take the other one right out.
Can I ask, is it a Jewish school and they're celebrating all the Jewish holidays? No.
No.
Oh, okay.
No.
I was going to say, that's how my son's preschool was. Oh, okay.
But we still pay. What? We still pay for half the month. And they keep doing this thing where, like, if there's a holiday, they're taking the day off after the holiday.
No.
And before if it's a holiday weekend, it's like, no, we don't do school on Friday or the Tuesday after Labor Day.
You know what else they're taking? You know what else they're taking advantage of you is what
exactly.
They're
exactly.
Yeah.
It's like when the Cadbury eggs every year got smaller and smaller, but they still kept charging you the same price.
Okay.
It's exactly like that. It's exactly. I'm confused by the whole is this a law or are these people just like, no one's going to question us? We can do whatever we want. You'll be like, there's no school Thursday.
It's
why?
The Wild West.
It's Goblin Day. Goblin Day. Yeah, it's the last Thursday in September. Richmond.
Sure. I mean, no, it's the Wild West. They have you by the proverbial balls. They already have your money and there's nowhere else to go. So, and you have these gremlins. I mean, they're gremlins, you know. And you need them to be somewhere because you have to work and do things. And so then they just, they just know that they can basically take all of your money. And I feel like the children are not in school more than they're in school. So
are you one of those parents where are you involved? Do you complain, not complain, but do you make suggestions? Or are you just standoffish? Nobody at school knows who you are.
Well, I was very involved in the preschool, very involved. And then my daughter started going to elementary. And then I learned about PTA. And then it was volunteering. And then it was fun runs and all the different fundraisers and all the different things. And I dropped preschool like a hot potato. I do not have the time. And I was also like, wait a sec. The preschool is like super funded and all these people, as I've just aforementioned, giving of their life savings. And some of these other schools, not so well funded. Yeah. And I kind of was just like, where am I going to put my, I feel like I need to kind of put my time into where we're going and where we're going to be, where we're going to be for longer. So yeah, I'm horrible. I feel like I don't know anyone. I'm just angry inside about it. And I don't tell anybody except for you all.
Honestly, it's a similar
premise. I just keep all my anger inside.
Whenever, like, we had a dog before we had kids, like, and listen, I know the dog owners are going to light me up for this, but you have a dog and the dog's your baby and you do so much with, and all of a sudden you have a couple kids and God love the dog. Still love the dog, but we're not going to the park as often. He's spending a good hunk of his time in the backyard going, hey, what happened to me? And that's, you know, we do the best we can. But once you have kids, you know, the poor dog is relegated a little bit. You know, he goes down to AAA. You know, he might come up for a cup of coffee.
I've met your dog, Jamie, and I'm not gonna. I didn't want to say this when I was out there, but he actually asked me to kill him because he was over. He asked me to end him, and I didn't want to do it because we're friends, but he did ask me to end his life.
Listen, but then the weirdest thing was he said it was because the Cadbury eggs kept getting smaller and that they were being charged.
Dude, that's awful. They can't have chocolate.
Well, I told you the story how the owl almost took him. I told you the owl story. We had an owl almost took the dog. Did I not tell you this?
No, we're all acting confused because you definitely told us, Cooler.
Well, we didn't. When I walk him at night, I have a golf club because this coyotes. Although I mean, part of me is like, he's eight. It's an 18-year-old puggle, Max. Yes. He can't see. Oh. He doesn't. So he's kind of old, and I walk him out. I try to take him for long walks, but he's like, dude.
Yeah.
It's like taking your grandfather to the bathroom and then saying, hey, let's go to the park. No, dude, bathroom, and then I'm back to the recliner.
Back to Jeopardy. So
he goes. I'm walking up. Like, he's just making the turn into the driveway to go up into the garage, like 20 feet from the garage. And all of a sudden, I feel like a jogger is running by me like this. Something hits my ear, nicked my ear. And I thought it was a jogger. And I was like, I was going to go, dude. And then I look in front of me, 8-foot wingspan right in front of me, lands on the dog, right on top of the dog.
Taylor.
An owl, giant owl. He lands on the dog and he tumbles over the top of him, falls on the sidewalk, and then sits up. And he's got the horns. He's a horned owl. And the dog doesn't flinch. The dog just keeps right back up to the garage.
Oh my God.
He just barely stumbled. No talons got him or anything. And then the owl stared at me. The owl was like staring at me. And I go to pull my camera out. I have pictures. I couldn't get the camera out fast enough, and he flew up onto the wire right above my head, and he just sat there and stared at me. I'll have to pull the pictures out. And the owl almost took – hey, the dog's too big. The dog's like 50, 60 pounds. He wasn't –
yeah, an owl's not taking Max.
I was shocked how big owls were. I was like – all of a sudden, I started thinking about pterodactyls back in the day of, like, death from above. I didn't hear it.
Flag on the play, because I got to tell you, how do you have a puggle that's 50 or 60 pounds?
I've met him. He is not lying.
He's probably a good 40 pounds. He's a big puggle, and he's kind of heavy.
I have a 40-pound kid who's like 4 feet. Like, what are we doing? He's a little overweight.
I'll weigh him later and I'll send you the details. But thank you.
I was picturing like a puggle, like a little circus music plays when they jaunt. You know, like
are you guys? Do you have pets?
I have two cattle dogs. I think one is, she's a little fat. She's in 60 some odd pounds. And the other one is like 50 pounds. I can't imagine an owl taking either one of them.
Is a cattle dog a wiry hair dog? No.
Short hair.
Have you had them before the kids?
Yes, we had them both before the kids. And here's the biggest mistake I made in my life. Okay.
Having kids.
Oh yeah. Well, as far as the dog is concerned, we got Cody when he was a puppy, and this was like when my husband and I were, you know, getting together, and this was our baby. I mean, it was gross though. Like we were carrying the dog around like a baby. We were like taking it on trips. This dog didn't want to be going on trips. so stupid. Anyway, I get pregnant and we go over to a friend's house and I hear this barking and I'm like, where's that barking coming from? That dog sounds like it's in distress. And my friend's like, oh, it's this dog next door. You know, they go on these camping trips. They leave the dog. And who's watching the dog? Oh, I don't know. I don't know. Who's feeding the dog? Oh, I don't know. Not us. I'm like, this is horrible. This is animal abuse. So I go over. I see the dog. She brings the dog to her house. She calls the neighbor. They're out of range. So I was like, you tell me if they don't come back for this dog. They need someone to take care of it. And here's my husband. He's just like, oh, no, I can see what rabbit hole we're going down. She is full of estrogen and full of empathy. And sure enough, they did not really want the dog. They were like, yeah, they had two kids. We're kind of bad dog owners. So basically you, Jamie. And they're like, we're bad dog owners. We kind of forget about him. We forget to feed him. And I'm like, this isn't right. I'm like, I will take and foster this dog. I save the dogs. And I took him to foster. And I couldn't let her go. And here we are 9 years later. I have the furriest, hairiest, sheddiest dogs. And she is crazy. She's crazy.
You let the dogs in the house? Are the dogs all over the furniture?
Oh, it's a nightmare. Yes. Oh, the one is going blind now. He's like sleeping with me. He's like in between my legs every night.
Oh, that's disgusting.
It's a nightmare. I haven't had a good night's sleep in like 7 years.
Justin got him started on dogs on furniture.
I mean, listen to my album. There's a huge bit. Max, I'll tip the lead. He pees in my mouth. That's a different story for a different moment. I was trying to train him and he pissed in my mouth. But my wife never trained him. He lived in a 5-story walk-up in New York City in Manhattan. As a puppy living in a tiny little apartment in a kitchen, and she, you know, I have to walk him 50 times. And so when we were dating, I took him to the park. I walked him all the time, but she never really trained him. So when he's in the house and she doesn't give him all of her food off of her plate, he goes to the stove and pisses underneath it.
Oh my God.
So that happened, you know, I put him outside, you know, like sprayed him with a hose, tried to do everything to get him to stop, but he kept,
Jamie, you need me to
20 times. And so I'm like, dude, I love you. You're living in the garage. I can't have it. Terrible. Yeah,
do you need me to rent an owl?
Honestly, now, I mean, knowing how Christine feels, I'm dropping the puggle off at her house. So yeah. you're going to think of it as a Christmas gift. He'll only be around for a while.
The dogs need to save themselves. We all need to just save ourselves. Okay.
What we need to do is invite Christine.
And I know
people
are going to light me up, but it's like at some point you're like, I'm so sorry. The two kids are my main concern at this point, but I'm the only one who takes care of them.
But they also live in the garage, so it's fine.
They shouldn't have pissed under the stove either. That's on them. They have to learn valuable.
It's called parenting. People, look into it.
Sounds like an awful lot of work.
I do love it is, and I, you know what, I love my dogs. I do. But my husband did say the other day, he's like, yeah, when they're gone, I'm done. I'm done for a while.
My kids were already planning the next dog. And I'm like, you're not even taking care of this dog.
They want cats and gerbils. I'm like, that's not going to work out. No.
You guys, I have a tortoise who is the easiest animal on the planet. And especially considering we live in a desert. So will he give you affection? No. Is he fun? Medium. But can he just eat your grass all day long? Yeah, that's
also
that's
they live forever.
Forever. Like I've never had he's gonna be 150. Like he's not my problem in like 30.
But he's gonna reach my age? He'll get up to my age?
He's gonna get up to your age, Jamie.
My God, that's insane. Nobody should have to live that long.
They say anywhere between 80 years and a Kaler. So
I met Tommy Johnson. He was delightful.
He is. They're dinosaurs. Honestly, dinosaurs were real and they turned into tortoises. I just want to be real clear about that point. He's got these little backwards wrists. Anyway, I'm just saying, look into it, guys. Then you never have to bury them.
How was your summer? Did you guys travel with the kids?
Oh, gosh. You know what? Summer was great, actually. We did do a fair amount of traveling. We started the summer off going to Wisconsin, which is where my husband is from, to my my niece's graduation party. She graduated from high school. Ooh. So she had a party. We hadn't seen them in a couple years, COVID, all that. So we decided to go and, you know, see them, see that whole side of the family. So my kids get there and they're like life of the party. My kids, there is not a party they have ever met that they don't like. And we get to this one, there's a big white tent and there's, you know, food and they're running around. There's all these kids everywhere. And I look over and I see my daughter running towards the tent. And then I look closer and I see her like, this is maybe 2 hours into the party. So a lot of apple juice has been had, like so much juice, so much fizzy juice.
Slippery slope.
I mean, there's a keg, people are drinking beers, Spotted Cow, she's having the fizzy juice. And I just see her start to shimmy the pole. And I'm like, hello? And I'm like far enough away that I'm like, I can't really, if I yell, it causes a lot more attention. Mm. It looks like it's stable, so I don't think it's actually a hazard. And then my, you know, number two is also trying to do the pole. But it was not to be believed. I was equal parts like a little embarrassed and also equal parts just totally astonished and really proud because I was
how
like,
far up
really
did she
hard.
Get the pole? Yeah.
Would you like to share the video?
Why don't we? Let's play the tape.
Okay.
In the USA, trailer park, truck stop, trailer, Matt, dot, New York, to LA. We
Wow.
Who said princess on me? She's got incredible, incredible form, by the way.
I mean, it's not quite, you know, S factor, but it's really getting there.
She's going to be a lot of fun at sorority parties. You know,
people were like, is that your daughter? I was like, yeah. Are you the one from LA?
She could be a very successful jewel thief.
That is Cirque du Soleil or a Second Story man. That's what's happening.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh my god! So then, like, number two just keeps getting juice from people, but the juice looks like Chardonnay, and I cannot tell you after that display, I had multiple people come up to me and be like, "I think he might be. You might wanna." And he's just like downing this thing, and I was like, "Sweetheart," and I'm like, "Oh no, it's just more apple juice. He's fine."
He's like, "Tell those brides to mind their business."
he gets there's a makeshift photo booth with one of those digital cameras, all the girls are taking pictures. You know, they're all 18. They're all taking pictures and blah blah blah. He keeps stealing the camera and keeps taking pictures, and I'm like, sweetie, stop taking the camera. This isn't your party, you know. But he cannot stop himself. He finds a boy at the party that he becomes obsessed with, takes about 15 pictures of him. Then the boy has to leave to go, and for the rest of the hour, went up to people with this photo as if he was in True Detective and was like, do you know this kid? Where's this kid? Where'd he be? Where did he be? Where'd he go? He became a cop. And I mean, it was hilarious.
What did he like about that boy?
I don't know. They were all, listen, this is the Midwest. Everyone is so nice.
Yeah.
I think all these older kids were just so sweet to both of them, and they were just having the best time. So then he found that little picture and he wanted so bad just to like hang out with them one more time. So it's like later and later, it's 10 o'clock, you know, it's like it's still light outside because you're so far north. Everyone's going down to a bonfire. I mean, it's really idyllic, I have to say. Catching fireflies. Like, this is all the stuff that summers are made of that we just don't really have all the time here. And I'm like, this is wonderful. Isn't this nice? And I turn around and my husband is assisting someone doing a keg stand on a pony keg, mind you. Mm-hmm. A pony keg. Yep.
We had a similar summer. On the right. And yep. I said the same thing. We had a similar summer. And I was like, oh, it was great. And then like 2 or 3 days later, I was like, all right, I got it. I remember this. I got it. Okay, I'm moving on. Yeah.
Could you do a keg stand at this point, Kaylor?
How are the mosquitoes?
You know, not as bad as you would think.
Not as bad as they are here.
No, I feel like they're horrible here.
They're so bad, and you can't see them. And I go out at 7 o'clock at night, and I get eaten alive. It's crazy.
I've never in my life. And they only want your ankles. They only want your ankle biters.
I have to like put on my crazy old man knee socks and go out at night, and people start laughing at me. It's crazy.
Oh, I need
you to. I have a bad summer with them here.
You need citronella candles, but you just need to like swing them on chains, you know, like some kind of weird like Catholic service.
Yeah, I was just like the incense in church.
The monk in the 1500s.
Just incense, just walk around. Or just start smoking. Just start smoking.
What was that band that did the chants or whatever? Not Portishead. That was
Dead Can Dance?
Dead Can Dance was one.
They have like that ethereal kind of very
poor. Enya?
Honestly.
Are you referencing Enya? And I'm asleep.
I had a girlfriend who loved Enya.
And that's why she's not your wife.
She was like, put on Enya. I'd go like, oh. So like, I kind of have a soft spot for Enya now. I really like Enya. Yeah.
You get a little al dente when you hear it.
A little al dente when I hear Enya. Yeah.
See how I borrowed from Kaylor's playbook there? You see how I did that?
I also I feel like it's such a poor use of al dente because that means with teeth, and I don't think that's what you really mean.
True.
Just say.
I always love, Christine always has, beautified in a positive. Everything's positive. There's no, like, we traveled with kids and yeah, there was moments of sheer like, this is awesome. But most of it was, we're all sleeping in the same room. I'm exhausted. My kids are driving me insane. They fight all day. But I love you're like a John Cougar Mellencamp song. I'm like, it's glorious. Remember those years? And then somewhere in the undercurrent of his lyrics, you're like, these people are, it's not going as great as everyone. It's like a Springsteen song. Like, we're not going to survive the night, but it's cool. Like that kind of.
It's the river. It's Bruce Springsteen's The River. The river. Like, we fell in love. Yeah. Oh man, we got stuck together because we had a baby.
Yeah. I got a job working construction down the Johnstown Company.
I'm pretty like, I feel like if I, you know, I've had so many terrible travel experiences that if I just get from point A to point B and have like a modicum of fun, I feel like we've done our job, you know, this is the thing. You got to put your expectations so low. Your bar has to be so low that just doing like the most like mundane things actually end up being the most amazing. I feel like maybe that's where I've gone. I don't know.
I love that you set the bar low. My wife sets the bar very high. My wife, she doesn't like the vacation as much as she likes planning the vacation.
Sure.
And after the vacation was over, she was in like the throes of depression until she booked the Christmas vacation. Like she needs to look forward to something, even though when we're in the middle of that vacation, it's kind of a train wreck and we're fighting stuff, trying to get times and schedules to get everything in. But she loves the planning of the schedule. Are you like that?
Yeah. Yeah. I generally do most of the planning. I'm good at it. Do I like it? I don't know. I don't know if I don't love being the cruise director. That's what I don't love. Okay. But when you've been the planner of the whole trip, then unfortunately you're like the only one that knows all the ins and outs. Like, for instance, did I tell you my story about spring break?
No.
It was the travel day from hell. I have never in my life. We planned a trip to Kauai. Now, my husband and I went to Kauai when we were dating. It's like where we fell in love. It was magical. I had this this vision of Kauai and hiking, and it's just amazing, right? So cut to, it's, you know, back in December, it's Omicron, everyone's getting sick, and I'm thinking to myself, I got to get the F out of here. And yeah. I just literally cashed in all the Delta miles that I hadn't used for 2 years, and I was like, we're going to Hawaii. So by March, this is going to be fine. We'll be fine. And if not, we'll just redeposit them. Well, it's fine. We decide to go. It's great. My parents decide to come with me. Great. What could go wrong? Two tiny children, two aging parents going to a very remote location on the North Shore of Kauai. Sounds perfect. We get up that morning to go to the LAX, and my husband, of course, finds some random parking spot that I'm sure is being run by, I don't know, something, some kind of illegal drug ring. Mm-hmm. We get there and they're like, no spots available, no spots. And we're like, but we paid $100 online. No spots. You go across the street. And we're like, huh? So we go across the street. We go up this huge structure. We finally get to the top. I mean, it's a shit show. We get to the top. We finally park. We like get all the stuff out. Now we're like kind of running late. We're like running down. We see people still waiting for the van. They're waiting for the van. Still, it's been like 45 minutes. And I'm like, this isn't going to work. We're going to have to call an Uber. So I call an Uber. We pack everything in this guy's car. We get to the airport. Okay, take a deep breath. There's a long line, but it's going to be okay. I think we're going to just make it. We check the bags in. We're fine. Then the Delta agent says, okay, so you're in Terminal 1. Y'all's flight has been changed to Terminal 5.
No.
Terminal 4. That's the international terminal.
Oh, that's the furthest one away. That's insane.
Do you know how to get there? There is a shuttle outside. And I was like, we're not making a shuttle. We are now running with our bags, our carry-on bags, and our two children, running to the international terminal. Because you never know. People are going to Turkey and Greece, and like it could be a line a mile long. We get there, sweating, get through security. Okay, fine. Now in international, it's like there's 1,000 gates. So we're running through the mall and I'm like, that looks nice. And like, wish I could stop there. Oh my God, they put in that? Like, there's so many fun things, but we have to get there. So I'm like running. Oh, we get there, like just as it's about to board. There's my parents. Oh, you decided to show up.
Oh.
Right? Like they took an Uber. They have no children. Their bags are like all carry on. Like they're just like on a Kindle drinking a coffee. Like you're so stupid. You too with the kids. Anyway, I'm like, it's fine. We're all getting on the plane. They come over the loudspeaker. Ladies and gentlemen, we have had a slight delay. And I'm thinking, oh God, what now? This plane will not be leaving for the next 8 hours. Everybody starts like rushing to get on these buses, to get back to another terminal, to get it to another, like, and now I'm just like, what now? Like they have our stuff. There's nothing you can do. Like, what do you do? So we just start like walking down to some bus to go back to a terminal. And now this is where my dad with the Kindle and the coffee really comes in handy. He goes, let's go to the Crown Room. And I'm like, free drinks? Okay. Yes, thank you, Jim Lakin, and your Delta Platinum status. Let's go to the Crown Room. So we go to the Crown Room. I'm like unpacking the sandwiches that I had packed 14 hours earlier. Oh. My kids are starving. I'm feeding them like depressing peanut butter and jelly. We're having mimosas. Like anything to make this trip going to be better. Finally, they say, actually, we have found a plane. You're going to be leaving in 4 hours, not 8. I'm like, cool. We'll get in. We'll still be able to get a rental car. We won't be there in the middle of the night. It'll be fine. Bunch of gate changes, a lot of other Michigan. We finally get on the flight. Well, the mistake I made is they've already eaten the smushed PB&Js and I didn't buy anything else. And this is now a 5-hour flight that is now leaving at like 5 o'clock at night.
Uh-oh.
My kids, like an hour in, are like, we're starving. And I'm like, I don't have any food for you. I have nothing. I am now scrounging the bottom of my bag for like smushed like jelly beans, like a cracked lollipop. They come by and I'm like, I will take all of the box. What do you have? I'll take whatever you have. They're like, we have beef jerky and nuts. And I'm like, they don't want that, but I'll take it. I will pay you $37 for beef jerky and nuts. And I'd like another wine, please. We finally get in to Kauai, right? It's 8 p.m. Like rental car place closes at like 9:30. So like time is of the essence. And nothing really there moves fast. It is the most remote and like old school airport you've ever been to. And when you're in love and you're like 33 and you have like a bathing suit and a dream, like you don't care. But when you have two children who are literally melting down and two aging parents who are like, we're so tired. And you get there, you're like, I got to get out of here. They lose our luggage.
You are lying through your teeth.
I now stand in a line to tell a woman who is writing on a piece of paper that might be carbon paper.
Nope.
Who then gives me like a carbon sheet after to
and
then
like scans your credit card like this.
I'm like, how are you going to find me? Oh, there'll be a van when we find your luggage and we'll just bring it to you. I have a carry-on that has, thank God, all of my children's luggage in it. Thank God. I am wearing a t-shirt that has been pitted out for now 12 hours.
Yep.
And what I have only what I'm wearing. No toothbrush, nothing. So that happens. We stand in another extremely long line to get a rental car. You know that scene in Zootopia with the sloths at the DMV?
Yes.
It's that. Yeah. It's that, but rental car. So, okay. My children now have second wind and they're just outside doing this. They're just like running around, but then they'll fall and cry and freak out. And then they'll get back up and start laughing again. Like they're in like that mode. Okay. So we get them in the car. Okay. Just get them in the car. I say to my husband, now I know this, where we're staying in our Airbnb, which is, you know, going to be in the dead of night. No street lights, nothing on the North Shore. There's nothing up there. There's like not a superstore. There's not a grocery store. I said, we have to stop at the grocery store. It has now been 16 hours since we left our house, but we have no food and I don't want to do this tomorrow morning. We have to stop at a grocery. I'm going to go in. I'm going to supermarket sweeps. 15 minutes tops. I'm going to get everything we need. I'm just going to do this. And he's like, okay, okay, okay. So we like stick the kids in the car. They're crying and whining, but in 5 minutes they're asleep. Thank God. Yeah. I go in, I start supermarket sweeps. I get, you know, some essentials, you know, magnum of wine, oatmeal, peanut butter, you know, bottle of vodka. I'm out. I get back to the car. Downpour. We start moving up to the North Shore. We like turn onto the one road. It's one road and it's two lanes and that's it. Standstill traffic. There was an accident and they shut the road down. We literally were just sitting there in the rain, standstill traffic. It is now 11:30 at night. Mm-hmm. And I just looked at my husband and I just started like maniacally laughing. I was like, it can't get worse. It honestly can't get worse. This is the dumbest trip we've ever been on. I cannot believe I cashed in 200,000 miles to go on this stupid trip.
Oh my God.
Wow. You guys, it was unbelievable.
And also 11:30 there is like 1:30 in the morning. No, 3:30 in the morning.
It was, what is that? Yes. And we've been up. I mean, we finally made it. We're like opening a lockbox, like
it's
in a condo and there's no light anywhere. We kind of like throw our children into bed. I'm like, you're fine. Shh, you're fine. I kept saying that. It's like, you're fine. And then I looked at him. I like poured myself a glass of something. And I was like, I'd have to take all my clothes off and put them in the washer. I mean, thankfully there's a washer and I'm just going to wear a towel for the next 2 days. I don't know what else to do. I mean, they finally found the luggage. It finally came. We were there for 5 days. And like the first 2 days, I feel like, it was not ideal, but we took beautiful pictures and no one could arrive there.
It is pretty there. It is pretty.
I feel so much better about my summer vacation. You guys,
you honestly really should.
Thank
but
you
do
for
understand?
Sharing.
Do you understand now why I go to Wisconsin and like, a keg stand, fireflies, and you know, my son being a cop is like the greatest vacation we've ever had.
That's all.
Well, you just wanted human contact after.
I got back, and people were like, "How was your vacation?" I go, "Well, I didn't really have a vacation. I was a full time butler. I was the financer. I had 50 jobs. I was cook.
Yeah.
I was lifeguard. I go ask my kids how their vacation. They had a fantastic vacation.
Yeah.
Sure. They were waited on. It was like Annie. They were just waited on hand and foot.
Yeah.
I mean, on the positive note, it's Hawaii. So at least you can put a bathing suit on, I guess. And kind of
Not if you don't have one.
Oh, I had to go the next day and buy one. And they were all so expensive. I ended up squeezing my ass into like a girl's 14. Because like, I am not going to also on top of this spend $200 on a bathing suit. So that one for $56, yeah, I can fit into a 14. Sure.
Oh, I love you, Christine.
My wife just
I had marks. Mark. It was painful.
My wife tried to book the Grand Wailea for Thanksgiving this year, yesterday. And she was gonna do the same. She was gonna cash in all of our points. And I go, whoa. Thanksgiving, I kind of like Thanksgiving here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fun week. Also, our friend has, you know, we have a couple friends who throw like it's a good week to not
there's
travel.
There's no one here.
It's the best.
No one actually here.
That's why I stay.
Yeah.
Back in the day before I had kids, when I bartended, I would keep all my shifts over the holidays. It was great. And then I would go in January. I'd go back home in January because
cheap
flights, nobody's – and January was dead anyway. So you'd go – yeah, I know. It's like – but people have this thing of like, I have to go for this frame of time.
Right.
It makes me laugh because my – you know, you'd go to do something and your father would go, well, you know, if your friends jumped off a bridge, would you jump off a bridge? And I'd always say back to him, I go, well, if everyone got in their cars and drove to the beach on the 4th of July, would you drive to the beach on the 4th of July? And he'd be like, wait, what? And I go, never mind.
It's true. Honestly,
if everybody jumped off a bridge and I was the last person left, I would definitely then also jump off that bridge.
Like, total swimming, of course. They're my friends. We go together.
I mean, I need some more information. Like, is there water? Is it cotton candy? What, like, a whole thing of Cadbury eggs? What am I jumping into?
Honestly, that was like a public service announcement just then for everybody's mental. That was like when we say mental health, Parental Mental Health Tuesday. That was it, because it's great when people see you tell that story, because that's, that was all of our vacations. I mean, that was extreme. That was pretty extreme, but
it was the worst.
No, I actually have anxiety from that trip.
I'm sorry.
I didn't go on. I was like, I think you have to stop now. I don't think I can hear anymore.
And just kept going.
And that was at the point where they walked back. So this is something that I'd always been told, but I didn't know it was true, which is once they push something like a plane flight back, they can't move it back up. But apparently they can. Like, if they push it out 8 hours, they can then say, by the way, it's... Because some people must have left the airport completely, Christine.
Oh, I'm sure. And I think they...
Did they miss the flight?
I mean, I'm sure they did. But this was the thing. Like, they, you know, I think they found... Like, the plane... Something happened to the plane. They had to dump a bunch of fuel. Okay. Something happened. It was not good. So we did not want that plane. I get that.
No one wants that plane.
But, like... Drunk, please.
But like, they found another plane, but then there was a whole thing with the pilots. Like, it was a very intricate story. And then we heard like the pilots were coming from Boston, but they were pissed and they didn't want to take the flight. And like,
we have to let Christine go, but really quick. Like, when I used to fly before I had kids, I had super anxiety until I got in the chair. Like, to get to the airport and everything. Mm-hmm. Once you get on the plane, I kind of would go, and I would kind of chill out a bit. And then I had kids. And everything was a nightmare every time you fly. And this, I just flew a week ago just by myself, and I got trapped in the airport for hours. It was the greatest. It was
like greatest day of your life.
Like, flight got pushed. I just sat. I watched TV. I was like, yeah, I'm okay. Like, I don't have any anxiety anymore when I fly alone. But when I have kids, I'm like, where are they? What's happening?
Of course. And you have to like keep them well fed and well entertained. I mean.
And they're still jerks about the whole situation.
I haven't pulled the trigger on a flight with the twins yet because I just don't feel like they're...
You're outnumbered. I don't know how you'll do it.
You'd be killed. All right, listen, we have got to let Christine go. Thank you so much. Oh, my gosh, your stories. Those are three. I see stand-up. But those are like stand-up
We'll turn it into something.
We got to get the next show going. anything you want to talk about? Are you doing Goldbergs now, or what are you doing now?
Oh, yeah. I'll go back to some directing this fall for sure. Goldberg season 10. So that's exciting.
Do you get tickets to the New Kids on the Block tour that's happening right now because you're friends with Joey McIntyre because you directed him on the Goldbergs, or no?
Oh, you know what? Joey and I have been friends for a long time. We actually did Happy Days the musical together before I ever directed him. I was Joni Cunningham, and he was the Fonz.
Was he Chachi? Oh, he's Fonz.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
He's
so
one. I bet you definitely go to his.
Okay, you definitely. Yeah.
Okay, you two talk. You talk in the private chat and go NKOTV.
Yeah.
I'm not asking you for tickets. I'm just saying, like, just tell me how it is.
Not like you were asking me for tickets. And honestly,
if I was asking for tickets, I'd be like,
you were asking me for tickets, Molly. However you want to frame it. All right, everybody. Christine and Lakin, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me, you guys. Appreciate it.
What a delight, huh? Oh, she can hear me still. Great, great.
You're still.
All right, she's awesome. Hey, I worked with Joey Mack, you know. I did the Joey Mack show. I was a soccer coach.
I was a Jordan Knight girl myself, if we're being honest. But I saw him in Evanston, Illinois once, and I was like, that looks like Joey McIntyre. What's he doing in my college town? And then later I saw that he was performing at a pub there, and I was like, wow, really missed my chance.
And you slept with him, didn't you?
No, I was not. Okay. No,
I was a grown man, so I was not an NKOTB. NKOTB guy. That wasn't my jam.
I'm realizing, can people see the private chat?
No.
Oh, yes, they can.
When Christine they sign could. On?
Oh, no. Yeah.
Oh,
Adam can.
Yeah.
Cool. Yep.
Does Adam know?
I don't know.
Oh,
okay, well, we won't talk about it. I don't think we should talk about it, but... why don't you do, Kate, because he's going to be funny. Will you do the intros for our old friend? I haven't talked to him in a while. It's going to be
fun. Oh, my God. Can I tell you, our next friend? Well, here's a fun distinction. I once, when I was 28 years old, maybe 27 years old, did a showcase show for myself. That's right. I threw myself a showcase show at TK's place, the Spotlight Comedy Club in Studio City. I had my friend Andrew Santino do a set. I had my friend Adam Harrington come do a set. Adam Harrington is coming to the stage with us right now. He's a Cape Cod native. He's tall. He's an actor. He's a dad. He's delightful. And honest to God, he was part of my life a billion years ago when I was having the most fun
of my life. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Adam Harrington.
That's it. Yay.
Adam, yay. I had no idea you were coming on the show, and I like legit got so excited.
Jamie snuck me in. Jamie, that's funny when you're talking about that show. I was talking about that show recently because I was watching Dave with Andrew Santino.
Oh,
I'm like,
yes.
I did some shows with that guy.
Yeah.
This is a fun show.
That show is so good, by the way, Dave.
So good, that show.
Ooh,
what's up, guys?
Hello.
Jason, how are you? Nice to meet
you. I'm good, man. Nice to meet you.
We
all used to do stand up. Adam moved to New York. He had a child. You want to pick it up from there?
Good night, everybody.
Thank you, Adam. It was the light.
Thank you, guys. Great. Thank you.
Anybody else? Do we have anybody else tonight?
You have a unique, I would say, you know, the beauty of the show, and it's funny too, because even having Christine share that awesome story of travel reminds everybody, it doesn't matter who you are, you are going to suffer. Maybe left so hard. You have a very unique parenting tale.
I do. Yeah. Unique's a good word. You know, everybody has their,
different paths.
I would call it like, we have a blended family, which was a term that I don't even know if I knew until
I didn't even know that. Blended family. Maybe some of the people watching are blended families. I'm not sure what that means, but
exactly.
Yeah. Well, is that?
It's like a mocha. If you put like, in like just cinnamon. And you just frappe. No,
and you can't take them back out.
You can't
blend it. It's done.
I feel like the first time I heard blended family was from my partner Shay. She just said it once. It was one of those where, like, you know, when something comes into your world, like a term, and then it's as if it always, I was like in a conversation, I'm like, that's it. And now it's just part. Yeah. So,
your wife, you say my partner, right?
Yeah, partner.
Well, by the way, she looks like Salma Hayek, or she looks like Penelope Cruz. I assume that she talks like these.
she does every other day. No, she she is a Turkish. Or she's
the most incredible, gorgeous woman on the planet.
she is very, very beautiful. Yeah, I made her. So. So you're
out of my own image.
Yeah.
So.
She's beautiful. She's so, like, you know, I had a child not by myself. I had a child, he's about to turn 6, Miles, my son.
Miles.
And I was like, so I was with a girl I was dating, and then before she got pregnant, we had broken up. This is going way back. The short story is that was like, you know, I've had outlines of like, this should be a show type thing.
Yes.
Broke up. We literally, it's one of those things where we broke up and we were kind of trying to work it out for a couple months, and then it was like, it's over.
Okay, hold on. Well, I think all of us know how children are born.
Yeah.
So when you were broken up.
Yes.
When you say we're trying to work it out.
Exactly.
I think we all get exactly what you're saying.
Well, that was a couple months of trying to work it out, and then there was that 5-day.
Called backslide. Those are called backslides, I believe. That's a backslide.
And then there was like I got to talk to you, a pregnant. Point is, long story short, that didn't work out. We were together for a little bit, and I was co-parenting with her for a couple of years in Brooklyn. My partner, my ex, she moved 12 days before the lockdown, March 1st, 2020.
Wow.
She moved to New Jersey. We were in Brooklyn. She moved to New Jersey. I had like agreed on it. You know, we had like we came to an agreement, almost used like a mediator, but it was pretty amicable. I decided, I'm like, okay, I will allow this, thinking like I will get an apartment. I was in New York. Career is going as it does, working, play, you know, busy.
You worked a lot, Adam.
Yeah, I was like doing things and like, I want to stay in the city, but I made the choice of like, she wants to leave and get out. So I like allowed it. Was it the right choice? It just was a choice. And the point is, life is all about choices. And I did it. And so then on March 1st, when she moved, and in the meantime, I had met Shay. I was dating. I met her. It got more serious. I was like, oh, I really like her. And I had told her up front, I'm like, it was like 3 weeks, third date. I had said like, I think I'm probably going to be moving to New Jersey. It was like, oh, okay. And then she's a New York girl, Tribeca for like 20 years, like just never leaving Manhattan type.
Which is weird that she has that accent.
But
yes, she's not a Portuguese. It's a meld of every European. She has two daughters, now are 11 and 8, or almost 8. But at the time, you know, it was a couple years ago. So long story short, like COVID happened. I was doing long distance co-parenting during a pandemic. Huh? That's like a sentence, which I never thought. Yeah. And it was like in Brooklyn. That's where I was. So
you had long COVID, really.
I had long COVID. it was a dark time for the world, but it was an interesting, cause like in New York, it was dark everywhere. In April in New York was very, very dark. And it was like, and she had moved to, March 1st. So I eventually got an apartment on May 1st where I like could be close for a while. But there was some times where I was meeting her, my ex, in a Wawa parking lot halfway, mm-hmm. to, like, pick miles up with masks.
Yeah.
And I remember knowing, driving, be like, this is such a fucking, in driving, you know, on like 95 through where, you know, it was like I Am Legend style, just driving through New York. Like,
yeah.
Like, I'm going to pick up my son at a Wawa.
And there's no one else on the road.
There's no one on the road. I'm going to bring back
my so crazy, dude.
And like bring back
Wawa lemonade, though.
What?
But the Wawa lemonade.
Exactly. I would go in and be like,
epic. Yeah.
Can I get a turkey club? I'm fucking white. It's delicious. They make a surprisingly good sandwich. And like bringing him back to New York, where like, you know, where all the playgrounds were shut down, like Terminator 2 style, like right before the world, you know, like the playgrounds were all weird.
And then the footsteps on the skull.
Yes. Yeah. I remember having every time I'd walk by a playground and like people would be like, get out. anyway, so that ended. And then bottom line is after COVID hit, like Shay, who was like, I'm never leaving New York, was like, get me the fuck out of New York. Sorry for sharing. And she is a different personality. I mean, she moves fast. She is a doer. Jamie, I heard you talking about like planning vacations.
Yeah.
Shay and Kate are in that respect, are literally.
I would argue every wife, because we don't. Yeah, they just, that's what they do.
That's what they do.
I'm gonna make a general sweeping statement.
Go ahead.
Do you not
agree
with the wives?
They're just totally worried about
Oh, I didn't say that. I said they are the vacation planners.
Yeah, and. What's different in our relationship is she does literally everything. I just look pretty and I drive. If we rent a car, she's not a driver. I'm the driver. That's it. I'm a chauffeur.
I'm the driver. My wife never drives when I'm in the car.
Ever.
Since I've gotten sober, I've become the driver. We get places faster. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's better than walking or walking.
Actually, I can't. When my wife does drive, I have to, like, she'll just stay.
Did he freeze for anyone else?
He did freeze for me.
She just plays paper, scissors, rocks.
Yes.
And then we decide who's gonna, decide who is going to. And then I'll finish the story for him.
Go ahead.
And I would just like to say that I worship I worship at the altar of my wife. She's the greatest person that's ever crossed these humble halls. And I'll tell you, every once in a while when I'm bagging on her, I realize I'm the bad part of this relationship, not her.
That's what he was about to say.
Is Miles still, it's weird that I think I know your son, is he still really big on buses and trains in New York?
Yeah, he's like, I mean, yeah, that's the crazy. We moved to the suburbs and he'll say like, just the other day, well, I like, do you miss the city? I mean, I miss the subway. I don't know if I miss the city, but I miss the subway. I just took him last week. I think I posted about it.
To Cape Cod for a cousin's wedding.
Yeah, it was before the wedding.
Oh, okay.
You know, before episode 78, episode 27 was, I took him to, because he hadn't been on a subway in a bit, took him on New Jersey Transit just for the hell of it to Newark Penn and went on the PATH train, because that's the one train he has not been on.
I love it.
I didn't realize you were East Coast like I am till you said Wawa. I'm just north of Scranton.
You're in Pennsylvania. That's why you're doing the show in Pennsylvania.
Yes.
We'll see you there, Adam.
I know. Actually Google mapped it. I'm like, oh, that's 4 hours.
Yeah. That's,
I mean, it's quick though.
It's a quick four hours.
Yeah.
I'm still getting to know this area. Like, there's so many talent. Like, I live near Princeton, next to Princeton, and like the townships.
Bragger.
Come on. I know. Prince, ever heard of it?
Never heard of it. I didn't go there, but I live really close to it.
Tell Princeton. It's very, it's different than the city. I mean, it is a big adjustment. For me as well, but like, especially for Shay, I mean, she's a city girl. So it's in the not driving. That was her biggest. So before we moved, it was like biggest fears. Mine was like owning a house.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, you know, moving, because she was like, I'm doing this because I want to do this. But I was also being like, you know, I don't. Hello.
He's back.
Okay. Oh, good. I'm glad he worked out his internet issues.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. At first I was like, what's wrong with you guys? All of a sudden, Jason, you disappeared. Then Kate disappeared. I was like, what's wrong with you guys, dude? And then I was like, they're all having internet problems. And then I was like,
Are you using Eudora?
So, of course, I walked out. My wife was like, yeah, that's been happening a lot lately. We got to get to the bottom of that. Exactly. I go, hey, is somebody on the internet? She's like, no, I keep getting kicked off too. What's happening with the internet?
It's like, what the fuck? Can you call? It's always if there's.
All right, listen, that's your third F-bomb.
I'm sorry.
The first one we let go because honestly, it fit. Family story. But
I just had that was a flashback.
Otherwise, Jason's got to go in and edit it.
No, I'm sorry.
What did I miss? Anything?
I started it, by the way. I just gave the rest of your speech that you were giving about your wife.
Thank you so much. Oh, no.
I can't believe you love her that much. That's amazing.
It's crazy.
She sounds perfect.
I mean, I must. Otherwise, I would have faked my own death and moved to Bali.
See, that's Adam, I'm currently trying to find his Halloween costume where he was like a number 6 subway.
Oh no. That was the...
Was Halloween costume.
Halloween 2019, and it was that was one of my proudest.
It's
dad moments. Only he was the bus.
The bus.
Yeah, okay, yeah. 38.
38. Okay.
B38.
Well, listen, I forgot some of the details, I remember it.
He was like, and my uncle helped me do it. He's like, my uncle's an architect. He's like, you know, when he was in New York at the time, so he's like crafty, and I'm like, help me make this thing. So he was got all into it and drew. He made this like incredible bus, and it was the coolest thing. He walked around.
You can't see it really. Let me see.
Oh, I can see it. He's a bus.
You guys. He's a bus.
And we were, and it's the bus that we would take in Brooklyn. We were walking around Brooklyn. We had a little party, and that's like somebody giving him bus fare because he had a card.
Oh,
he had the little hat. You can't even imagine how cute.
I love that. That's so great.
It was pretty cool.
Now, Adam, as far as the three brothers, you're the only one. Are your parents, Matt and Jay don't have kids, right?
They do not have kids.
Are your parents like...
By the way, Matt is the oldest of you, right?
Yeah.
No, he's just the most silver.
I was going to say, he looks so good silver, Adam.
He's the middle. Jay's the oldest.
Jay's the oldest?
Matt's the most silvery.
Yeah. Matt, I was like looking at those Cape Cod pictures. I was like, all right, Matt Harrington.
Are your parents giving them grief, or are your parents? I think my parents,
who I think are watching, are beyond grief. No, there's no, it's just, listen, I used to do in my stand-up a long time. It was like, you know, at this point, I have two older brothers who are 40, blah, blah, blah. And none of us have kids. And so at this point, my parents just hate us.
Yeah.
But now, and so now it's like, there's the one, and it is, I mean, here's like you, it's the same. It's for, with anybody. It is a huge joy, like for real, like of being like a, seeing like your parent, like facilitating in a way, like being that to like the relationship between your kid and your parents. Like, because you have to kind of like make the time and like, and it's amazing. And like when you see that relationship grow, it is amazing. But when there's only one, I'm not gonna say pressure, but like it's a responsibility in a way. But it is like, it's one of many responsibilities.
I think parents love seeing it because then they go, do you get it now? Do you see what we put up with?
Yeah, of course.
Like, I told, like, and I told you so almost. Like,
yeah.
See?
No, I mean, and now, like, because of my blended family, I have, I mean, you know, I am, I have two stepdaughters that, and we, you know, they go to their dads sometimes, of course, but like much of the time there's three of us. And in that time, just of the actual logistical taking care of having three kids, it's like, and because my parents had three kids, it's like, and they had it all the time, and three boys, and understanding that is like, wow, that is, that's a lot.
Do you guys have your son and your two daughters, are they lined up on the same schedule so they go and come?
Yes.
You did it.
Oh, yeah.
You have three kids and then you have no kids.
That's so we made it, which is like, it's like, any, it, yeah, I mean, it's like anything. And, you know, the situations we have when you have co-parenting, and it's not ideal. It's like not what you thought, but like to make the most, the best of a situation, like that's, especially Shay coming out here changed her life completely, and mine as well, 100%. But it's like, so like if that was part of, it wasn't even a deal. It just made the most sense. And they go to their dad's every other weekend, and Miles is with me here a lot. And so, yeah, so we have every other weekend essentially. And then the summer schedule is very different. It's been all over the place, but yeah, we have kid free weekend every other weekend. And during, especially during COVID, when New York hotels were like $120 for about a year, we would go in and there again, get to New York in like 40 minutes. And just some hotels were open. We just kind of hang out. We did that every other weekend. It was awesome.
That's so fun.
So we're the absolute opposite, where we have two children and we have no family to watch them.
You
so
have no time.
We don't, we are never, we're never away from our children.
I could see that from your, I follow you. Hi.
I'm Jamie adjacent, where we have family close by. They just refuse to watch our children.
Yeah.
They're terrible.
And he has three children that nobody
wants.
It's like going, oh yeah, bring children to the corn. Let me see if I can watch them. Nobody wants that. It's terrible.
Right.
And I don't know. I don't know where I fit into this picture.
No, you don't.
I also don't live by family, but Jamie, the thing that's different for you, Jamie, though, is you lost your parents before you had kids.
Well, that's what happens when you have children at 50.
That's what happens when you're
that was the biggest lesson I learned. I go, why can't you have kids at 50? And then I got to 50 and I had kids, and my parents, like my mom was alive for a couple years, but she was in her 90s.
Was? Oh, I didn't.
Yeah, she met them. She met them both.
Oh, she did meet them both.
That's so sweet, Jamie. I didn't know that.
For like a cup of coffee.
I'm so sorry.
Just enough to go, he is heterosexual. Like that was it. Like just one final, like.
She ever spent any time with you?
Before she died.
She ever spent any time with you?
Oh, are you kidding? She came out here so often. Yeah, she was great.
She was like.
And it was so, at the end, I was so bummed that my father would have been like, he would have loved to have met them to watch me suffer. Like, he would have enjoyed every minute of me suffering. Like, he would have been,
By the way, Kate, I need you to get pictures to put in the Parents Lounge logo, because I'm tired of trying to explain that Jamie and I are not two dads raising four kids together. And much more than I'd like.
It does kind of look like a wacky like 80s sitcom. Like,
yeah.
My two dads.
Now it's going to be like, it's just like polyamory. It's just like my right. two husbands.
That's well, Adam, I have a question for you. How is it?
Blended.
I mean, because I have two daughters that I are at that, like one's 9 and one's 7. And they're already like, not like just going, no. Well, you're like, I'm sorry, what did you just say?
Yeah.
I need you to do this. No, not doing that.
No.
It's like, I'm sorry, what? How is it dealing with, have you heard the, you're not my dad yet? Or
it's not really, yes. To be honest, I was actually just talking about this today with a friend of mine, one of my best friends from LA, who also is a stepdad. And it's a very like, obviously like unique role, and like, you know, I don't give them. It's like you're a friend, but you're also an adult figure, and you live together. So like, and you're the adult in the house, but I don't give them consequences. That is not my place, right? I don't, it's not like you go to your room. If you do that as a step parent, it's like, it's not, that's not a good.
But the problem is without consequences, my kids would.
Exactly. But it's true. Like if I were to be like, I can't be like, go to your room,
or no iPad.
But like, that's no the thing, like Shay, but Shay is, she's amazing with like, she knows that. So she'll be, you know, she's there for support, but yet like I will lose patience. And if there's anything about like the house of not picking things up or being disrespectful or rude, it's like, I do, you talk to them like as if a parent, but there is a fine line. And sometimes when the, you know, Ella who is getting maybe in something with her mom. And if I feel like something crosses a line, I'll say something. There is that, like, you're not my dad. A little, it's like, I know. I'm like, I'm actually not trying. I'm just saying, stop being a dick.
Have you ever said like, I know I'm not your dad because I'm here.
Ooh, oh, Mulligan.
See, what I did there was I burned the child. That's right. I think what you're supposed to know.
Right.
Well, let me ask you this, Adam. Does Miles have another male figure in his life yet? Because I imagine that's going to be hard. Does your ex?
No. So the other interesting addition to this, which is like, is that so my ex had a child on her own, had a baby, like, you know, by herself.
Well, it could be yours. No.
No. From science, she had another one.
Science.
So number two. So Miles has a younger brother who's like a year and a half. Just lives in, and she and my ex has her mom moved in with her. So like she.
There was a donor.
Donor. No, it's donor.
Anytime you say donor, all that means is it's the doctor who runs the donor lab.
That's
the doctor's like, I fathered 700 children.
Yeah. That dude's a stud. No,
he's a total stud.
That's so
unique, man. I know. Is she dating a guy or no?
No, not at all. At this point, no. But that was the other like part of it. I mean, just to get like during the COVID thing, and it was all during, again, same thing going back and forth to Brooklyn. It was just all the stuff, blah, blah, blah. And like, I was also on my off weekends where I was not with Miles. I was spending time with Shay in the city because like I knew we were already committed and I'd go there for like a couple days, but everybody was being very careful as far as like, you know, gloves, all of that. But I just did. And I didn't for the first couple of weeks, I actually didn't tell my ex that because we were like, things were got a little weird, but I'm like, whatever. It's not. But then eventually I did after like 2 or 3 weeks. She was not happy about it, and I get it. It was a weird time. So it was this whole conversation, but it got like really tense of just like, she was almost like, I don't want you seeing her. I'm like, well, that's not going to happen.
That's actually not an option.
Yeah. But, and then it came out where I was like, what is going on here? And eventually I had this conversation with her. I'm like, we have to talk face to face. And that's when she told me, she's like, I'm pregnant. I was like,
Why?
And that was only 2 months. So anyway, that was a long time ago. And now things are, you know, they live 3 miles down the road.
I'm so confused. Is she with her family?
So her mom moved in with her.
I was going to say somebody moved in with her because you couldn't do it.
Yeah.
Her
mom moved in with her. So, and now it's interesting because when that happened, I was like, okay, so that's another thing. And Miles loves his younger brother. He loves his older sisters. It's amazing for Miles. Really is it? It truly is. He has these two sisters who he's like, they're my sisters. And then he loves his younger brother, but it is like, as he gets older, and now I'm starting to know Charlie a little bit. That's his younger brother. When I pick him up, it's really just at that level, but he's talking a little bit. But like for the first time last week, when I picked Miles up, Charlie was crying, and I'm like, that's going to keep, like, his younger brother's like, he keeps going away, you know?
Yes. Oh, he was crying because Miles was leaving.
Yeah. Yeah.
And were you like, all right, fine, I'll leave him here.
Leave him here, which, but.
That is odd. That's a little unique.
You know what I mean? And as that gets.
Why older, wouldn't she ask you to be the donor? Right? Am I crazy to go like, look, I've got one. Listen, I know we're not a couple, but. Wouldn't it be great if they were full genetic siblings? But and then
at that point,
I'm getting a donor. Why not have you donate?
At that point, she wasn't even okay with me. Like, stopping by unannounced, or not even unannounced, but no, that, like, you know, that was, I know you're being
That's because she was seeing the guy that runs the clinic. So she
dude, this
Narcolepsy 27. Yes.
He's killed the jokes. We have so many people who kill the jokes. My two donors coming.
My two donors
coming. That's really funny, dude.
That's not working tonight for some reason. But every
girl asked me years ago to donate.
For real?
Yeah.
Like,
it was a friend of a girlfriend. And the girlfriend kind of was like trying to get me to do it a little bit. And I was like, I don't feel comfortable with this situation.
That is like,
I had a similar thing where a friend
pondered, it was talked about. And I was like, no, I don't think so. Thank you.
I had a similar thing where a friend and her husband couldn't conceive. And they asked me if I would donate because, and I was like, but you've seen my face and the genetics that are coming here. Sure, that's what you want to do? And
you've seen my face.
I kind of said the same thing. I said, I mean, do you want a pasty, white, redheaded ginger? I mean, is that really what you're looking for? Because I
mean, and that's how Andrew Santino was born.
And there you go. Ladies and gentlemen.
It's called a callback. Adam, when you do a one-man show about this, can I open for you? Because I owe you.
Adam, I mean, I know you're doing tons of theater in New York and TV over there and stuff. Yeah, I mean, this is, you know, Chaz Palminteri sat down and wrote A Bronx Tale. It was his childhood. He did it as a one-man, it was a one-man show before it was a movie. It's super interesting to me, man. I'm so glad you came on because we've all kind of like, we're old friends, and I see your Instagram, and I'm always like, I'm trying to put the puzzle pieces together. Right, it's super intriguing. I mean, especially now the ex with like living with her mom to go like,
right.
You know what? I'm going to have a second.
Which is also like just very on brand for her. I mean, not whatever, she's great, but like, it's just funny, like different personalities have just like, I don't need, you know, like it's just on brand. I was like, when I found that out, I'm like, I get it. Yeah. That wasn't that surprising.
The problem is donations. You need, so it's really expensive to get a donor and to go through the whole process. She met you in a bar and was like, look, this guy's tall, good looking.
That's
insane, it. Very talented.
Related to that silver fox.
It was a free donation. And when you were like, it's not working out, she's like, it's not working out. Not yet, but it's going to work out soon.
Right.
Do you want to make up? In 3 days?
In 3 days.
Ovulation test?
Let me take my temperature. Oh, yeah. We should go out, I think, Thursday morning about 9 a.m. Wait, that's a weird time for a date.
Also, Caleb, what is it that you think taking a temperature is? Because you definitely just...
I said to you, I was like, I'm taking my temperature.
What are you doing?
I don't think about medicine. Listen.
I think I'm ovulating.
It was that scene in Big Lebowski with Julianne Moore.
Jeffrey.
Physical act of coitus. Physical act of love. Jeffrey.
With who's the guy, that one of my favorite actors of all time. Is the guy in the room who's got the laugh, the cackle.
Oh, yeah. He's like,
he's a huge actor. What's his name? He's.
I forgot who that is, actually.
It's going to bother me.
Coitus. Physical act of love.
He's like,
how's your smut business, Jack?
He's in Harry Potter. He's one of the teachers. That dude's in everything. Yeah. He's so good.
Adam, not to take it to a serious note, but you are legitimately one of the most delightful dads I've ever seen on Instagram. And I know it's all a facade, but the way you adore your child. And by the way, Jamie, did you also think that the mother was dead? Because like when I was trying to piece together Adam's name, I remember when I reached out to you.
Yeah, I remember that. And I just realized like, I never responded to you, did I?
No,
like,
you did.
I did, like, eventually. Okay.
No, it's all good. Like, but I was like.
Yeah, you were wondering what the deal was.
I was like, I'm sorry if something tragic happened, but if this is a good thing, I'm happy for you. But
I knew a little. But isn't it weird? Like, it is funny. Like, all of our old friends, you look at their Instagram, and it's like a mystery. It'd be really a good show or a good premise is we go unlock the Instagram story where we take a bunch of posts and you put them together and you go, here's what's happening.
Yeah.
It's not going well. This person lost their job. They're trying to make you think they're in Hawaii. We should like.
Totally.
I would have lost because I would have been like, his new girlfriend, Shay, has an accent like Penelope Cruz. And they would have been like, nope, you're wrong. And I'd be like, and the ex is dead. And they'd be like, nope, you're terrible at this game.
It did not sound like Penelope Cruz. It sounded like Pepe the Muppet.
The Muppet.
That was the Muppet that was canceled a long time ago. They got rid of that Muppet.
It is crazy to have that path. I mean, are your brother? What do your brothers say? Are they like, whatever, dude? I've seen photos of them with Miles, and that's great.
Oh, they're. I mean, listen. Yeah, that's the other thing. Is like, I don't want to keep saying the word facilitating, but like seeing those relationships. Like, I have my family, my brothers, and my parents, and they have a lot of like, I have a big family of cousins that I grew up with, and you know, the wedding on Cape Cod.
I was there, guys. It was great. It was a great
week. But like all of that, when you like see those people who get to know your child, like that's a very specific, it's like so, you know, it's like so fun. It's awesome.
Yeah.
It's like the best.
Caleb. No, not for Matt. Matt and Jane, not even close, are they?
You know, if you put odds on any of us, I wasn't close at the time. It just happened. Yeah. So like anything could just happen.
Again, I don't know if you know how children are born. It didn't just happen.
No, I know, but it happened quickly.
You
know,
you did some things.
Sometimes it just happens.
You did some things.
This is how babies are made. When anybody asks me, when two people argue a lot, they break up.
There's a 1 month period.
There's a 1 month period where they break up. And then one night they put their parts together, but only after the lady says she's ovulating because she clearly wants to have a secret baby.
I have another friend who did that. They broke up. They had a big weekend away and they came back and they broke up. And then she called him a few weeks later and
when I think of it as the, you we all think of our lives as TV shows, but it's the end of the pilot, like the opening the door and because there was even a moment, because there was like, you know, you have that time of when you break up with somebody and then there's text, like, I need to see you. And I'm like, what could this be about? And I remember hanging out with some of my buddies in New York and having that conversation the night before. That's like 10 minutes before the show ends. And they're like, dude, I think she's going to say she's sorry for everything. And I'm like, no way, you know, whatever. And then I walk to do. I'm pregnant.
Oh, I was going to say STD. I was going to say STD.
Yeah, there was also that, too. Like, all
one dude's
that.
Like, dude, she's got the herpes, man. Yeah, come on, like, buddy. She's going to tell you she got that.
In person and tell me that? Like,
I really need to tell you something in person.
In person.
I have black plague. I'm sorry, what?
I have the clap. Yeah.
That's so funny, dude.
Yeah, so, but anyways. But, yeah, but listen, awesome. Now, like, and now we have a... We bought a.
I mean, let me ask you this: Are you gonna? I mean, you say my partner,
right?
Are you going to have another wedding in Cape Cod?
Are you going to form an S corp?
I know, I don't. I know it will not be in Cape Cod. No. She has said that only, and mostly because she has a lot of hair, and it's like big, beautiful hair, and she's like, I can't. It's just too humid. We can never do it.
Too humid here.
Yeah, and I'm like, why are you speaking like that? You're from Turkey and grew up in Long Island.
Was she married before with the two?
She was, yes.
She was married, yeah.
She was married, and...
Do you get along with daddy?
Yeah, you know, I don't... Yeah.
I mean, come on. Why is this the most attractive family of all time?
Yeah. I know, that picture. I just, like, that was from a play I did, and that was... I was trying to find, like, one where we're... We have some other ones.
I mean, somebody's been very conveniently cropped out of that photo. Can we pull that photo?
It's actually, it's Shay's mom. I don't know why I did, but I like, it was made it small on my phone. Dude, you emailed me earlier too. I'm like, I was like,
it looks like somebody's stealing your child out of that
photo. You know where I was when I emailed that? Is where I was literally outside the Nassau Inn where you got married today. That's where I was. Full circle.
You were in Princeton, Nassau Inn, where Daddy got married. Yes. I got married at the Nassau Inn across from Princeton.
You call yourself Daddy? Because
I'm Daddy, yeah.
Yeah, you're Grandpa. Let's be clear.
Oh, I'm Big Daddy.
You're Big Pops is what you are. But also, if you said to me, guess what word was in the name of the place where Jamie got married? Nassau is 100% what I'm going with. Nassau Inn. So... Yeah. Waspy, Kaler.
NASA, the NASA Inn. Nassau's all over Princeton.
I mean, in Princeton, Princeton, New Jersey, and it was very nice. And it was
Princeton, New Jersey.
Yeah, the church right there on the street across.
And then we raised all two girls in a Catholic school.
Which is funny because neither of us went anywhere near Princeton or any Ivy League school, but we got married in Princeton,
New Jersey. We got married right there, right where Michelle Obama just
ruled. Yep, everybody. Brooke Shields. The only way the people go to Princeton, I go Brooke Shields.
Yeah. You're like Albert Einstein, Brooke Shields.
Yeah.
How do, I'm realizing.
Well, he taught there. I don't
think he did. Yeah.
The last time I saw you, I realized, is when you graduated from Groundlings and you happened to be in the class with Jesse Schneiderman.
Oh, yeah.
I was teaching at Bar Method with at the time, and I showed her the showcase. How long ago was that?
Well, that's so funny. Wait, so you were at one of those shows?
I went to, yeah, it was the last time I saw you. And I was like, Adam Harrington? You know, like, and your brothers were there, I feel
yeah,
like.
Yeah, yeah. And like, because that's like a bit, you know, the it was the advance, the final show of.
Yes.
Like, you think of these moments in like your life of like sliding doors moments. And because I was in LA forever. And in 2012, I went to New York for like a year, almost 2 years. And it was awesome. I was doing all this TV and theater. I just wanted to go. It was great. But I came back for the Groundlings. That's why for the advanced, because you're on a wait list forever.
Forever. For years.
For years. And so I did that and I came back and I didn't get in, you know, I didn't get in. And I was like, and I was fully accepting, like, all right, this may not happen. But it was like, it really, like, for a little bit, it totally knocked me off my feet way more than I thought it would. I was just like, wait. And it was weird. And then then I went back to New York, but then came back to LA because I didn't want to leave LA being like, because I didn't get into Groundlings. Basically why I say that, in the meantime, I went back to New York and that's when I met like my son's mom. I had already met her, but that's when I went back to like really be like in a relationship. And if I had got into Groundlings, I would have stayed for another 6 months. I would have been son. I never would have gone back to New York and Miles never would have been born.
Yeah,
it just wouldn't have happened.
But don't you also wonder how many kids that would have been awesome that haven't been born because of what you did?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No, it's just totally.
You don't even know, but you in a different world, you had a kid named Jackie who was amazing.
It was amazing. I know. It's just like, well, if I had done one thing in one of those sketches, if I was just like, I had her, and they were like, that's it. If I wore a better wig.
The way, it's all about the wig at the Groundlings, baby.
It's always the wig.
They should do a Doctor Strange multiverse film where in each different multiverse, he has a different family. Like each one.
For real, because that's how it is.
Like, it would be super funny to have a multiverse with a father who's like, all right. And each time he opens the door, there's like a different family there. He's like, oh,
these are all good ideas. You have to be, put that in the notes.
Yeah, let's put that in the notes for the night.
You hey, Narcolepsy 27, can you get on that?
Let's. Yeah, I know. You're the one who's doing the most.
Doctor Strange. We should call it Daddy Strange Multiverse.
Daddy Strange Multiverse.
It's just about you.
Instagram reality or Instagram behind the life.
Actually, I think the Instagram thing would be super funny. We should take, we'll have, what we should do is that when we have the guests on, we should take like select.
Yes. And analyze them. Like,
and we should show them and show like maybe their very first Instagram photo and then maybe pick a handful through the history of their Instagram. It'd be super funny. And then go, what's happening here?
Yeah.
What were you thinking?
And also like you could act like whoever gets the closest is the winner.
Yeah.
Doctor Strange.
Doctor
Strange. That's actually really good. That is a deep meaning. Doctor
Strange. It is, yeah.
Doctor Strange.
Well played, Martin.
Really good. Apatow? Who is that?
Yeah.
He's our resident joke writer, dude. Yeah. We need to start bringing these guys on and giving them like 5 minutes of to
joke. Mulligan, did he come from your camp?
Yeah,
he did. Everybody came from Mulligan's camp.
By the way, also Adam, it's so funny. Adam is there. Paper, scissors. But Adam also is a friend of the Schmodown because Adam. So we used to do karaoke. Do you remember the Schmo karaoke?
Yeah.
And I won the first. I found the funniest either email that you and I sent to each other or like a video where you won the second year.
Right.
And you were like,
I don't think I won. I think I was like, it was the, it was the talking crap before.
You muted yourself, Mulligan.
She's like,
I just had the best bit of my life.
Can everyone tell that Mulligan is overwhelmed that Adam's in the room tonight? Like,
oh my God, I'm so excited. We're talking
about parenting stories, and then Mulligan's like, hey,
wait, you remember?
We were at that bar. Oh, it was like 97. And you, do you remember that night? That was
so fun. He's being so kind and pretending he has any idea who the hell she is.
Going down the rabbit hole of Harrington tonight.
I'm just saying that for the people that are here from Schmodown, they would also love Adam Harrington because he's a friend of the show. So Kaylor, Harrington, myself, we all came up at, Kaylor was already on my voice.
Soon, isn't he? Christian Harloff's coming on the show soon.
Yes, he's going to come on.
We're going to do a
trade episode.
It's awesome. I love that you guys are, you're all doing that. Like, I mean, huge and that you're part. It's so awesome. I love it. I watch all of it. So
yeah. Cool. Well, it's ending. The plug got pulled.
All right, listen, Mulligan, you're off in your own private tangent.
I remember, you know, this is going live, right?
This isn't just.
I don't remember something. I'd like to hear Adam's memory.
No, I just
had a fun time in my life.
Well, this is also, but it's actually about people. I just remember years and years ago walking on Third Street Promenade and seeing Harloff and Mark getting a slice of pizza and going to a movie, and they were like. Yeah, we're starting this, like, did they say blog? Whatever it was back then about movie reviews. And I was like, cool.
Good luck.
Yeah, and like that's because, and they just did it forever and they did it and they like created like an empire. Because they're like, that's what we're going to do hardcore for a long time.
Yeah.
Very specific. Yep.
Yeah. And Adam, were any of us at the intervention of one of our friends? No, right? Were any of us there?
I was there.
You were there?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Then never mind. It's not as funny.
honestly, we do need to wrap this show. But I will tell you very quickly. If anyone out there has ever done an intervention, like when you read like stories about interventions, people go, you know, all my friends got together. It was really tough, but it really cleaned me up and it really helped me. And everyone's like, yeah, we love him so much. And it was every intervention story you ever hear is like this warm, loving, oh my gosh, I can't believe you guys care about me. I'm going to really take care. And it goes off to like positivity. We, like 10 of us, did an intervention. And he's basically, it was like, none of you guys are my friends anymore. And that's the end of this story.
he was like, LMNOP. LMNOP.
We all said, hey, listen, you're dying. You need to stop this. And he was like, no. And I don't give a what you guys think. And it was like, all right. I guess we gave it, and everyone was like, well, we tried. That's the best we can do. We all left.
All you can do is try. He's doing fine.
He's doing fine. Yeah. I don't want to say names.
Yeah, yeah.
But at the time, listen, everyone's got it in their own. I think it's like the same with your parenthood. Everybody is on their own path in their own time.
Listen, on our own path. And also, like, it's true. And I'll just say, like, it is, it's amazing, I know there was conversations about like, oh, it can be challenging, but it's like, I was talking with Shay the other day. It's like, it's so amazing because we look and, you know, most of the time it's like our kids play together like they're siblings. They fight together as if they're siblings. All the stuff. And it just kind of like happened because we made it happen, the two adults. So it can be hard, and like sometimes it's all this stuff, and as any parenting is, when going on vacations, we just were on one, and it's like, oh my God. But then when you really sit back, it's like, you know, family is. This is my saccharine moment. But like, it's like, it is literally what you make it. Mm-hmm. So.
But don't ever forget, you're not my father. Don't you ever forget that. You have to go, when you guys get married, you adopt, and then that night you go, I am your father.
I am your father. Yeah, exactly. Your father.
Now go clean your room, or else.
Like this paper says, I'm your father.
Yeah. Like, your father. And then frame it. I'm your father. All right, listen. Dude, it was great to chat. Ladies and gentlemen, Adam Harrington coming in tonight. Is there anything you want to promote? Do you have a new play that you're doing?
I did a thing that I put on Instagram. It was just cool because it was my first like big recurring thing on a I did a vo- uh, voice on the Netflix Jurassic Park Camp Cretaceous. It was
it's my buddy. It's Scott Kramer's show. Scott Kramer, yeah. my old buddy from Acme made that show. Yeah, that's, I saw that. Really awesome.
Really. I did when I did the thing. You know, I did it on like at a studio. I was with him the whole time. On like
yeah, Kramer's
like,
the best. Man. He's the best.
He was such a nice dude.
He's the best. Yeah, he created.
What are you on there? Because that's my oldest favorite.
It's a really cool show. So season five, I'm Dodgson, which is the Campbell Scott character from the movie.
Oh, right.
So I basically, when I got the thing, it was like almost a Campbell Scott sound alike, and I didn't really know what that meant. This was a year and a half ago when I did it. Anyways, it came out, and it's pretty fun to see. And
yeah.
Cool. So that just aired.
Super cool, and honestly, it's something for your son to be like.
Yeah, I showed it to him, and he was like, that's you?
Yeah, awesome, dude.
I know.
Like, really great.
They made you, I mean, why'd they make that guy? They made him old, though.
Yeah.
How dare they? You have a very youthful voice.
Well, no, but Campbell Scott's kind of old. It's basically has
and it segues into the last movie, too. Yeah. He was kind of old.
You know how old Campbell Scott is? He was kind of the dicky guy in Singles. With Kira Sedgwick and Matt Dillon. That's Campbell Scott.
From 80 to Kaler, what is he?
Dude, Kaler, literally you should do another thing of just like why are you look the same as when like,
it's unbelievable.
It's crazy, it's not the most maddening to be honest.
O'Brien's. I remember first meeting you at O'Brien's when you were Marta. It's the same face. You have the same
I'm shooting Tacoma FD this week, and they love having the police. My hair is way whiter, and they are big fans of having the police captain have bright red hair. So they brought me in 2 days ago and dyed my hair red.
Oh, for real?
Made it bright red.
That
so
actually
I was shooting Thursday, but yeah, I'm doing a couple.
But that's like also, that looked really real. I mean, that's very good.
Honestly, well, on camera it does. In person, it looks a little. It's got a little Bryan Cranston going on. Where like, that guy looks way older than that hair. Yeah.
But my husband, who is like obsessed with Jamie, is just like, but like, why does he look so young? Like he just. And
it's the unicorn tears.
It's really
until
is.
Jay Larson came on last week and told me that we have a friend Greg Fitzsimmons who I went to college with. I didn't know him then, but apparently he was talking and Fitzsimmons said, it's good to see somebody who looks old. And I was like, wait, what? So now I got a little bone. I'm gonna have to.
Also, Jay Larson was like, "That's absurd." Kaler's the youngest looking 58 year old that ever lived.
Hey, I'm not 58 yet. Not till September. By the way, Kate's husband Dickie's a fantastic writer. Adam has a one man show in the works. So let's get this together.
You've got to start writing
that stuff and getting on stage, especially with your theater connections in New York.
If Shay's watching this right now, she's going to be like, I told you, because she's the same. She says the same. Yeah. I know. No, you're right.
Dude, come on. We'll riff it out. But listen, I love you. Thank you so much for coming and playing.
Yeah, nice meeting you, man. And
Blended is the name of the show. Blended is such a great title. Yeah. The whole Blended family thing is really interesting to me.
There's a Sandler movie called that.
You're right. It is. I was like, that's a great title. That's been a movie, but no, we'll figure it out.
I still think My Two Donors is still.
I think that's the one.
Honestly, My Two Donors might win. All right, that's it. I'm going to let everybody go. Go find him on Instagram. Katie's mom ever. Jason Gowan. If you guys love this, please, for the love of God, go share, love, subscribe, write a review. Buy tickets. We're going to be in Sayre, Pennsylvania in October. Right there. The three of us are coming out to do some live.
Yep. Tickets came out today. You can get it at BradfordCountyMovies.com.
Actually, not a far drive from Jersey, brother.
He looked it up. It was 4 hours. He's like, that is definitely, that's a boundary I won't cross.
4 hours? Oh, please. 4 hours,
yeah.
Four hours before kids? Yeah, it's a long drive. But once after kids, 4 hours is gold.
We did a 7.5 to the Cape. I hear you. No. Yeah. Maybe I got you. I know that weekend is a no kids weekend, actually.
It is. Come on up.
It is a no kids.
Let's recreate some room five memories.
5 minutes, though, brother. You'll have to break out some of the old shit.
Oh, really? I could do that.
Yeah. All right, everybody. Listen, thank you guys so much. It takes a village. So we'll see you guys next time here on the Parents Lounge.
Good night, everybody.